You know, in movie news recently, Jackass Forever is doing gangbusters at the box office. Actually, I hear Johnny Knoxville is going to start up his own restaurant because of the success. It's going to have some vegan options. So you can have chili con carne or chili concussion.
Nice. And it's good that you mentioned restaurants, because Sopranos actor Joseph Organascoli, who is the actor Vito from The Sopranos, is actually coming to Ireland. He's opening a pop-up restaurant overnight here. He's also begun looking at other business opportunities. I hear that he's looking at getting into fertility treatments. In vitro fertilization is going to be a big deal in the future.
We recently got Oscar nominations. This year's Best Pictures, some of the longest movies on record. It actually averages out to about 140 minutes for all of the movies averaged together. Incredible runtimes, incredible length. When reached for comment, Bradley Cooper of Nightmare Alley said, "I think that's about average." I mean, that confidence he has, you have to assume. Yes, you have to assume. You don't have to assume if you've seen Nightmare Alley.
No, you don't.
Well, hey there, Internet. My name is Jack Packard.
I'm Darren Mooney.
And today we will be talking about the schlock fest that is Moonfall. And later, Omar, Marty, and I are going to be talking about... The Book of Boba Fett? Ah, shit! Ah, fuck! I said I wasn't gonna talk about- So hello and welcome, this is your feature presentation. So Darren, Moonfall, it is a movie about the moon crashing into the Earth and a group of intrepid underdog astronauts trying to stop it. How can this not be the greatest movie ever made? That's my question.
And my answer would be, if you watch it, you'll find out. So I feel really bad about this because I know you really enjoyed it. And I know a lot of people who really enjoyed it. I did not kind of glom to it. I feel like it's probably better if I go first so I don't feel mean following you. And my big issue with it is that I looked at it and I kind of saw the depressing future of the non-IP derived big budget blockbuster. It is a movie where you can see that absolutely every single shot in the movie was composited in front of a green screen, including Patrick Wilson riding his motorbike through Los Angeles. It's a movie where it seldom seems like there were more than 20 people on set at a time, and not just because of COVID restrictions. This is a movie where characters launch a mission to the moon involving five characters in total. Three of them in the rocket and two of them in the control room. And because of budgetary constraints, the control room is basically my home office that I've been working from for the past 2 years. It's a movie where characters who have to enact the idea of gravity being affected by how close the moon is literally have to skip across a green screen to create the impression that they might also be pulled upwards.
Mm-hmm. I have yet to hear anything wrong. Yeah.
This is the thing with it where, like, I understand the appeal of it as a B-movie. And, like, part of me is, like, if you want to film it as a B-movie and put it on sci-fi and, like, cast the Oscar-nominated star of the Stalked by My Doctor franchise, Eric Roberts, in it, then please, please go ahead and do that. And I will watch and I will enjoy and I will cherish it. But part of me is also, like, I love Roland Emmerich movies, as dumb and as bad as they often are. And the reason for that is because they offer scale and spectacle and magnitude and, you know, things that exist beyond my capacity to process. Independence Day, you know, even 2012, even, you know, The Day After Tomorrow, where they outrun cold. They're all big, bombastic movies. And I watch Moonfall and it constantly feels like a knockoff version of those. I feel like this would be an enjoyable movie if it were made on, like, a budget comparable to 2012. But I'm watching it and it feels weirdly sad and funereal and kind of depressing. That it's like, yeah, this is where a blockbuster that doesn't star a superhero is right now. Sorry, that's my immediate reaction to it.
No, and I think a lot of that is very fair. Like, specifically, there is kind of, in the third act, there is a car chase. Standard car chase that is clearly all CG and has absolutely no life to it whatsoever, except for how great that Lexus looks.
Which may also contribute to lack of budget. Like, and it's really depressing because even the product placement in this movie feels like it's third rate. Like, you know, I'm not a huge fan of product placement in general, but generally, like, it adds this weird sense of verisimilitude to it, where, like, Bond drinks a Heineken and it's like, okay, Bond exists in a world where Heineken exists. I don't buy that Bond is ever gonna go, of all the options, I will have a Heineken, but I go, okay, that is a world in which I exist. Moonfall exists in a world where Kapinski antivirus is taking out gigantic billboards all over, like, Florida or Los Angeles, wherever this is based, where, you know, all the software equipment is running Kapinski antivirus all the time in block capital letters because they agreed to pay for the product placement on it. I don't know if Elon Musk and SpaceX paid for the product placement they get here, but it is decidedly conspicuous and distractingly conspicuous. Our good friends at SpaceX. What would Elon do? And the fact that the entire, like, premise of the movie is Elon Musk's nightmare.
All of your criticisms are very, very valid. That being said, I still think it's big, dumb fun. You know, like, we still get those epic spectacle shots. We still get weirdo sci-fi elements that should not make any sense, and it doesn't matter that they don't. When the moon is so close that it's messing with gravity so people can jump really high, or a car can jump over a chasm. Oh, that's great.
When it's scraping the top of buildings. Like, those are the moments where I'm like, this is what I want. Give me this.
Yes. Yes. And it's so much fun, and Roland Emmerich is so good at efficiently and quickly establishing, yes, stock relationships. Ah, it's a father worried about his son. Ah, it's another father worried about his son. Ah, wait, this one's a mom worried about her son.
What if there's a weirdo who believes in conspiracy theories but is entirely right and sacrifices himself at the end of the movie, maybe, like every other Roland Emmerich movie?
It's those, like, very simple relationships that do help you as an audience, like, really, like, root for the protagonists of the movies as they do stupidly insane, nonsensical things. And so, like, to me, this was cinema. This was sit back, watch the flashy lights, and have yourself a good time.
To be clear, I'm not saying it's not cinema. don't put that on me.
You heard it here first, folks. Darren says Moonfall is not cinema.
Yeah, that's right there. I think, like, and now I'm on the back foot, so thank you very much for this, Jack. But no, like, it is recognizably like the Eurotext of Roland Emmerich movies. It's got all the stuff that, like, Roland Emmerich loves. So it's got, like, ancient astronauts in there. It's got conspiracy theories that date back to the dawn of time. It's got, like, a bunker where all the most important people in the world are meeting and living. Although, again, it feels like a budgetary constraint that the president isn't a character here, as if they couldn't license the character of the president. They just couldn't afford it. Right. It's got, like, all those dynamics and all those relationships that you mentioned as well, they're all taken from, like, standard Emmerich movies. And you can point to everything from Godzilla to, you know, to The Day After Tomorrow. There's a point here where they outrun gravity, which is very much a sequence lifted directly from The Day After Tomorrow, but just substituting gravity for cold. There's another sequence where the characters stumble across other survivors. And of course, it's a caravan of refugees living in mobile homes, because that's how Emmerich seems to see America, which, again, I kind of love. It's the combination of all that with the fact that it feels so, like, funereal. It feels kind of like, and it's, to be fair, I think the film is aware of this. It's a major plot point that, like, NASA A, has no resources whatsoever, and B, the mission is being, like, sabotaged on the inside because they don't have the resources to actually accomplish what they want to do. So I think the movie is aware of its budgetary constraints and almost kind of writes them into the plot.
Sure.
But it feels like very sad. Like, when I was watching it, my feeling was, this is sad. This is like, I want to see the movie that is this movie made 10 or 15 years ago. I don't want to watch one that we kind of ended up with.
And, you know, that actually rolls me into my next point, which is, like, you know, overall, obviously, I had a really good time watching the movie. I think it's fun if you go in with those expectations of, oh, it's dumb. Don't you worry about it being dumb. But that's fine. I think, like, you know, we've seen a lot of interviews with Roland Emmerich recently, because the movie is bombing, to put it lightly.
It's falling to Earth. The investors aren't over the moon about the return on their investment.
Nice. Very nice. Maybe we'll see it crescent eventually.
It's being eclipsed by Jackass.
Ooh, very much so. And so, like, you know, Roland Emmerich is saying,
another
like,
full
oh.
moon picture. Sorry.
Because of his butts.
Yeah.
And so what we have here is a situation in which it is a read the room situation. It's like if you compare Moonfall to something like Spider-Man No Way Home, Spider-Man No Way Home is the comfort of nostalgia. And we are still going through, no matter how many people deny it, we are still going through a global pandemic. And so having that little like comfort food Spider-Man movie, oh, I remember all these characters, I like this, is it's not surprising that that movie did so well. In contrast, we have a movie in which we see looting and people hoarding supplies and people attacking each other who are all just trying to survive, and conspiracy theorists and religious fanaticals. And you know what? It's just hits a little too close to home. There were some definite parts of the movie where I was like, oh, could we cut out the fact that grocery stores have limited supplies of things right now? Because I don't want to feel that in my big dumb action movie right now. That's what's happening in real life, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like that's the thing with the Emmerich. I was kind of surprised at how well that played, because going into it, I was like, okay, I have a checklist of things that I know I'm going to get from an Emmerich movie, going back to Stargate, for example. And I know I'm going to get batshit conspiracy theories about who secretly runs the world and how everything you believe is a lie and how the insane people are actually secretly the sane people. And I think an interesting test for me watching it was a real sense of no. This is still so batshit that it manages to out batshit reality. So I still cross the threshold and I can go with it. I don't ever feel uncomfortable that I'm rooting for John Bradley's "The Moon Was Built by Aliens" astrophysicist.
Right.
I do think it maybe suffers a little bit from, and again, this, all my complaints, and it's a really shitty thing for me to do, and I fully hold my hands up and say it, and I feel bad about it, but all my complaints of it seem to come down to the lack of budget on the movie, because one of the things that really really stood out to me about this compared to Emmerich's other movies, and interesting you should say nostalgia, because I would argue Emmerich is one of the last directors making like old-fashioned disaster movies. Like the movies that he makes are basically like the spiritual successors to The Poseidon Adventure and all that sort of stuff, or Earthquake, or The Towering Inferno, all that sort of stuff. But like the cast in Emmerich's movies are largely carried by these incredible ensembles that he has. And you think of things like Independence Day, where how much of that comes down to the simple fact that Will Smith is one of the most charming blockbuster leading men in the world, and that Jeff Goldblum was like the Vin Diesel of the 90s, come fight me, internet. Against all odds, for 2 years, he was our Vin Diesel, and those were some great 2 years.
Great times.
You go beyond that, and it has this incredible bench where you've got Bill Pullman in there, you got Thora Birch in there, you got all these kind of characters who are like all these actors who are like phenomenal, and it's got this really deep reservoir. And with Moonfall is in a weird situation where I don't think, ironically, despite having an Oscar winner in the lead, Halle Berry, you don't have a movie star in here at all. You have maybe five character actors in there if you count Donald Sutherland's cameo.
Sure.
And outside of that, you have this like really shallow bench of people who are not very good at like carrying or communicating depth. And I don't want to single any of them out, but like once you get past Halle Berry and Patrick Wilson, who I think are both really solid here. Wilson is one of my favorite, like that guy, I will throw a movie on my back and I will carry it, guys. And you get past like John Bradley, who's incredibly charming, and Michael Peña, who is massively underrated. I think even in like Tom and Jerry, he was a highlight. And here I'm like, I want to follow Michael Peña. Michael Peña's movie is the one I want to be in, because that seems like it'll be
incredibly underutilized in this movie. Absolutely.
But like you get past that and it's just this sea of undistinguished like supporting cast members who often seem like they're reading their lines off cue cards. And it doesn't like it. Part of me is like, I can see a world where Chiwetel Ejiofor is playing this part and it's much better. Or I can see a universe where John Cusack pops up here and it's much better. But because the movie has no budget, it's like a bunch of people who don't even have Wikipedia pages are kind of like in major speaking roles here. It's not a level of fame thing. I'm not saying that they need to be stars, but I think there is an issue with like the level of ability in the cast, maybe. to help carry it.
No, I think that's fair. There is that like unseen charisma factor that can really help smooth out some of the harsher curves specifically to Roland Emmerich's movies, where like it doesn't matter if the big alien ship makes any sense because Will Smith is there and he's enjoyable on screen no matter what. What I'm getting across here is I think that like your criticisms, the internet's criticisms of the movie are completely valid. I also think the fact that it's bombing so hard at the box office makes complete sense. Even if we weren't in a pandemic, I could see this incredibly underperforming at the box office because of the kind of movie it is.
Yeah, and it would also be like it would be, as if the pandemic wasn't happening, like Morbius would still be dominating cinemas. You have to assume that Scream and Jackass, which are similarly nostalgic projects, would also be dominating the box office. You have the Batman around the corner. I don't think there's any world, whether this one or the one or planetoid orbiting us, where this movie like makes its money back, which is really depressing because like my main complaints are they should have given him more money. And the other complaint is there's no universe where anybody giving him the money he got is getting their money back.
Right.
So it's those two things that are impossible to reconcile. And I feel really bad. Like I feel really bad that I'm kicking the movie for this because like I shouldn't be. But it's inescapable when I watch it. And like I'm not raging against the machine. I'm not saying this is the worst movie I've ever seen. I'm just saying I watched it and I felt sad. And you shouldn't watch a movie where the moon is literally falling to Earth and a bunch of three plucky astronauts, including one who believes the moon was built by aliens, are trying to save us and feel sad.
Right.
Sad is not the feeling that you should have deep in your soul when you watch that movie.
And I think that's incredibly fair. I still think it's worth a ticket. Now, to be fair, I did see this on a Tuesday night, which means I could go with my entire family. It's, you know, like it, incredibly discounted prices Tuesday night. So my whole family got to go for the price of what is usually one ticket. So I think that might factor in
your enjoyment.
So like, you know, for the $5 I spent on my ticket, I rather enjoyed it. And I think like if you are able to gloss over some of the bumpier effects, some of the like I will say joyless, lifeless effects, I think it's enjoyable sci-fi adjacent schlock.
That's fair. And I mean, I feel like I'm harshing your mellow. I feel like I'm really being the Grinch who stole Christmas here. I wanted to love this. I was really excited for this. I was really looking forward to this. I was sitting in my seat feeling anticipation for it. And I just feel really bad that coming out of it, I'm just like, eh.
That's all you need to know. Like, I know you give movies significantly more credit than any human should. And so if you're coming away a little mad, that speaks volumes. Oh, all right. And now here we are. I'm here with Omar and Marty. And there's a television show about a Mandalorian that's been around for a while. It's called The Book of Boba Fett. Earlier in a Your Feature presentation, I said I was going to not watch it. I'm not watching Boba Fett. I'm not going to do it. And no one can make me watch it. And guess what? I didn't watch it.
You know what? I'm going to be honest. You didn't miss out on much.
Yeah.
If I have to be honest, you might have made the right call on that one. Which sucks coming from myself and Omar, who were 2/3 with Rachel of the Escape the Galaxy crew. We want to love Star Wars. Like, we want Star Wars that makes us passionate. And for me, this was not Star Wars that made me passionate.
Hey, this made me passionate in different reasons. So
passionate is a multifaceted term.
Yeah.
So I guess, yeah, Omar, like, what were your just top-level thoughts on Book of Boba Fett?
This is something that you and Darren touched upon when you first talked about this, that they were trying to do a show about Boba Fett and trying to make him interesting, yet getting sidetracked with all these unrelated backstories and not doing the underground crime scene and all that. Like, it's not that they couldn't have told an interesting story about Boba Fett. It's that they just kind of gave up halfway through and decided to make Mandalorian Season 2.5.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
Wait. What does that mean? As someone who hasn't watched it, give me a little more context.
It means two entire episodes of the 7-episode run are ostensibly devoid of Boba Fett and are just about Mando going on adventures and going through his sort of Darksaber adventures, which is where the end of season 2 left off, and then reconnecting us with Grogu and Luke in their training.
What?
And so,
what?
Yeah,
we get Grogu?
Yeah, and Ahsoka, and you know, bringing back Ahsoka Tano. So
many more Mandalorian characters, like Cobb Vanth, the Marshal from Tatooine, the other Tatooine lady that I don't know her name. Just, this is Mandalorian season 2.5. It's ridiculous.
By the way, what is it with Star Wars shows that they don't let the titular character of the show have their due? That was the same problem with Mandalorian season 2. It's like, just, no, it's the Mandalorian. Let me hang out with Mando. In the Book of Boba Fett, let me know what Boba Fett does.
To me, Book of Boba Fett is like the epitome of what the Disney era Star Wars has been, which is, every time you think it's going to try to look forward and do something new, it ends up, who is it to like turned over and looked over their shoulder and they got turned into salt? Is that something from the Bible or from mythology? Someone looked over their shoulder when they shouldn't have. And I think they got turned into salt.
Is this Legends?
The Star Wars Legends? Yeah, it's no. I think it's Earth Legends.
This is biblical legends. Is that Gilgamesh?
Is that canon? But no, it's Star Wars has this it has this tendency now to every time we get somewhere like The Last Jedi that we think is going to take us somewhere new, it inevitably has to be like, let's go back to our comfort zone, which is inevitably Tatooine seemingly in everything. And so that's what happens again here. Yeah.
Honestly, the most striking scene in this entire show to me was that first like Mandalorian season 2.5 episode where we just have this one take of Mando walking through this like halo ring kind of space station.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was just so unique in Star Wars. It looks like something more out of like a Star Trek or something more heavy sci-fi. I mean, even then it's like a character we're already familiar with that they're drudging up for no reason. But then even then we go back to Tatooine for the rest of the show.
Yeah, that's I would say literally, I think that one-er that Bryce Dallas Howard directed near the beginning of that episode was probably the highlight of the season for me.
Which is really weird.
Yeah, exactly. It's because I was like, ooh, I haven't seen a place like this in Star Wars before. Like, this looks like really cool and tangible. And to juxtapose that with, like, I still think the stagecraft, which is how they filmed this, which is their crazy like little like warehouse in
the volume.
Malibu. Yeah,
where it's like the screens everywhere,
right, where they have like a TV instead of a green screen.
Yeah, but it's all like done in like Unreal, I think, and it's all like projected live, so you're really able to act off it. I think the locations still look great, and like even in the episode after that where they go to the planet that Luke ultimately, you know, sets up his Jedi temple on, and has all these, it's like a bamboo forest, it looks really cool. Doesn't look like anything else from Star Wars. That looks great. And then when they show Luke in broad daylight for extended periods of time, and you see the deepfake technology that they use, and like the deepfake voice they use. Like, I'm not even sure if it's a modulated version of Mark Hamill's voice.
He has no intonation at all.
Have you heard anyone talk like that back home?
I mean, to be fair, they did do a better job. I think they did a better job with his, just like the realism of it, even though it's still in that uncanny valley. They did do a better job, and they got that one guy who did the really famous deepfake of Luke redoing it for Mando season 2. So they hired him.
They brought him aboard, yeah. Which is cool. Yeah,
that is cool. But can I take a small side tangent here to say how creepy technology is getting? Not only are they puppeting the corpse of Peter Cushing in the movies, now, like, Mark Hamill is still alive and quite literally more known for being a voice actor than an actor at this point. You couldn't get him in there to say a few words. Like, they are puppeting the alive now, which is horrifying. Let the dead die. Let people get old, please.
I know they did have him on set for Mandalorian season 2. He was there during that cameo scene. I don't know if they actually like used any of that footage, but he was on set and he was reading the lines, but I think they read it everything.
He was just counting money while they were filming.
Just sitting in a chair.
Is this what $100,000 looks like?
Wow.
I thought so it'd be nice. Bigger. yeah, I think that the de-aging technology, when used right, I think can work. Like, I think it worked in certain segments of The Irishman, and I think it worked for like Sam Jackson and Captain Marvel, or for Robert Downey Jr. at the beginning of Captain America Civil War. But this whole thing at this point, like, just if Luke is going to be an integral part of these shows going forward, which he might be with Ahsoka, like, we don't know how much of this they're going to show, just recast him. Like, well, first off, I would rather just let's not tell Luke stories. Let's just tell stories about new people, because this is a big galaxy. But if you're going to do it, just recast him and we'll all get over it and eventually we'll move on.
Sebastian Stan is just sitting there looking like a young Mark Hamill. He's not getting any younger either, by the way.
You know what the problem is, though, is that he's on that Pam and Tommy show. And so he's having conversations with his penis on that show. I don't know if you guys have watched the Pam and Tommy show. Jason Mantzoukas voices Tommy Lee's penis. And so he has a conversation with Jason Mantzoukas, who's his penis.
No, no. And then that's just like Luke talking to his lightsaber. Same thing. Same thing.
Lightsaber.
What's a lightsaber but the penis of Star Wars?
So I guess, Omar, what did you think, I guess, of the finale? Like the you know, culmination of this all, I guess.
You mean where the show that's supposed to be Star Wars does The Godfather has Don Corleone ride a dinosaur?
Oh, yeah. Boba Fett rides a Rancor through the streets of Mos Espa and just like wrecks things.
Well, first off, it's beautiful because when the Rancor shows up, they play like a Godzilla sting, like. And then the Rancor climbs a tower like King Kong. So they are going deep into this.
All right. All right.
Yeah, it is funny because at a certain part, like the Rancor, they use the Rancor to destroy these big sort of walking mech tanks that have shields that none of the guns can pierce. But then Boba gets off the Rancor and the Rancor just goes wild. And it turns into like King Kong where it starts climbing shit. And everyone's like, oh, we got to shoot him down. And I'm like, did no one have a plan of like maybe bringing a Rancor into the city isn't the best idea? Yeah, that happens. Grogu shows up and uses the Force to mess with some stuff and Darksaber. It's just a lot of stuff happens that genuinely does not matter.
Yeah, and the whole thing, I just want to talk about the whole thing with Grogu and Luke and Mando, how they deal with it in the show just really, really annoyed me. Because the idea of Mando leaving Grogu with Luke at the end of season 2 of Mandalorian, that's like him accepting that even though he loves this kid, he has to let him go to be safe, right?
Of course.
And then immediately, Baby Yoda is like, hey, no, screw it. I'm going to go back with Daddy because he gave me shiny things.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Boba Fett makes him a little baby onesie mithril armor. Like, it looks like the mithril armor that Frodo has in Lord of the Rings, but he makes, like, a little version.
Yeah, yeah. He puts it in a little pouch, he brings it to Luke's temple, and he gives it to Baby Yoda, and then that's the impetus for him abandoning the Jedi way.
Right, so any sort of, like, character development as far as, like, Mando and being a parental figure of, like, letting your children, you know, grow beyond you, all of that means nothing.
We are back to the beginning of season 1 of Mandalorian, where he's just taking care of this kid. Nothing has changed.
Perfect. Yeah, we're resetting faster and faster now. That's great.
Hey, but now Mando has a sword and Grogu has Mithril, so...
This is true. And, like... Okay, so the reason that Grogu gets the chance to leave is because Luke gives him this choice, right? He's like, you have this lightsaber, this is Yoda's lightsaber, and you can have this and you will continue on the path of the Jedi. Or you can take this armor that Mando gave you, and then you're going to go be back with him, but you're going to abandon the Jedi ways and no longer be allowed to train here, right?
Sure.
And just, why would you trust a baby to make a decision like this? This is a baby that was eating the eggs of an endangered species because he was hungry, right?
Yeah.
It's like when, you know, on like where they have like divorced couples and they put the dog between them and have the dog like choose which parent it wants to go with. And it's like, of course, it's going to go with dad because he put like fucking treats in his pocket. Like,
wait, like waving a steak around. Come on, come on. Come on, Grogu. Yeah. Oh, that's
perfect.
Mando's out here flying. It's like, yeah, come with me. I'll fly you around in my cool new spaceship. He gets a cool new spaceship in this season, by the way, because that's important in a Boba Fett show. And I'm going to like give you a ball to play with. And we're going to have adventures throughout the galaxy.
Well, one, this is like set part of like the Star Wars that I like, which is that Jedi are boring as fuck, which is like, that's canon. That's great. And two, it also sets up that Luke is a terrible parent. Like, you know, we get the culmination of that during The Last Jedi. But yeah, Luke makes bad decisions. Luke should not be a leader of anything. So I guess that works as a setup. Great.
Yeah, I guess so. And to be fair, like I think there's some redeeming qualities on the show. I think literally Baby Yoda, I think, is just still the cutest.
Oh, sure.
Anything
Absolutely.
He does is great.
Absolutely.
Like, there's a scene where he's walking alongside Luke and Luke needs to like force kind of give him forced little hops for Baby Yoda to keep up because he moves so slowly. Incredibly cute.
Oh, yeah. It melts my heart whenever I see that thing.
Yeah, A+. I mentioned the stagecraft stuff. I think the settings still look really good. I think it has some decent character work out of, like, really minor characters. Like, there's that Major Domo, but he's played by Selena's husband on Veep, who's, like, he's, like, an improv actor from Chicago. Very funny. Mm-hmm. Very dry. Like, him and Amy Sedaris, like, are shining beacons on the show. And then I liked Cobb Vanth.
Yeah.
He's great. It's exciting that he's obviously going to be coming back, you know, in the stinger for next season. So there's some good-ish things.
I do wish there was more Danny Trejo in the show. He shows in for one episode as the Rancor trainer. He's the new Rancor trainer in Jabba's Palace.
Hell yeah, that makes a ton of sense.
Danny Trejo is unexpectedly becoming a geek icon between being like, I want to be in Star Wars and like, I want to be in Animal Crossing commercials.
Right.
Good for you, Danny Trejo. I like it.
This is one of my favorite spots. Butterflies.
So, like, at the end of the day, when I saw, like, the little teaser at the end of Mandalorian Season 2 for Book of Boba Fett, my expectations were Boba Fett and Fennec are going to start up a crime empire, and that is a show that I want to watch. But knowing, you know, myself, knowing how Disney deals with Star Wars properties, I knew they were going to fuck it up. And so, like, I guess, like, how does this compare with your expectations? What were your expectations? And I mean, obviously it didn't meet them because we're here complaining about it.
Yeah, I think I've been burned enough by Disney when anytime they try to say, hey, this is going to be different because it's going to be the blank of this property. Like Omar mentioned, it's going to be the godfather of Star Wars, or like, you know, when they make a Marvel movie, they made like Winter Soldier and they're like, ooh, this is going to be like the Parallax View. This is going to be like a sizzling 70s thriller. I'm like, no, it's not. It's not. Like, I like Captain America Winter Soldier, but I'm like, stop doing that. Yeah. Stop like trying to compare it to these like beacons of cinema. I was hoping it would just be about Boba Fett and like, I don't know, just take him to different places instead of literally going back to Jabba's palace. I'm like, I've been here. Like, I love these places, but we could just look forward. Like, we don't need to keep looking back, which puts me in a funny spot for the poster came out yesterday for Obi-Wan. And I'm like, ooh, I'm excited for Obi-Wan now. And I'm like, Marty, you fucking idiot. Why are you doing this?
They just reeled you back in.
She hasn't changed, Marty. She says she's changed and she hasn't changed.
Yeah.
Stop going back to her.
I need my friends to just sit me down after every Star Wars thing and be like, you gotta rethink this.
I don't think there's anything inherently saying that you can't take a character that wasn't interesting or developed in, you know, previous iterations and make them interesting. But this show just didn't, it seemed like it knew actively as we were watching it, as week to week, they were getting the ratings in. They were like, nobody's watching this show, pivot. Even though they couldn't do that, obviously, but it seemed like that's what they were doing. And it's just really frustrating as somebody who wanted to see something interesting and potentially darker from Star Wars.
And it's, again, I know a lot of us here at The Escapists are kind of negative on Book of Boba Fett, including Darren. If you liked it, that's totally fine. We're not going to yuck your yum. You can like whatever you want. Just get, if you're going to get mad at anyone, get mad at Jack. He didn't watch it.
Yeah, I don't watch it. I don't care. You know, like, To me, it's one of those like dollar vote things, right? Where it's like, this was very similar for me when like Star Trek Picard came out. As a huge Next Gen fan, that should have been right up my alley, but I could see. And so I haven't watched any of it. Same with the Hobbit movies. Hobbit's one of my favorite books. It's a great story, but like the writing was on the wall. I still have not seen the Hobbit movies. And so it's like, if they don't have my view number, that is one less for them. And if we keep dollar voting and if we keep saying we're not watching this, then maybe they'll say, hey, our numbers are going down and down. We need something new. Like Mandalorian, to me, season one Mandalorian, that was where it was at. Where it's like, hey, this is kind of like the thing you like, but a new side of it. And everyone said, yay! And then they, you know.
No, it's funny that they did that at the end of season two, because like that show, like Mando became like the biggest monoculture thing on TV since Game of Thrones, and they didn't need to do the Luke thing.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like they were like, oh God, what do we do? Let's bring back Luke. Like, you're the most popular thing. You can do whatever you want. And like, if you tell good stories, and I trust these guys to tell good stories, like Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni have told great stories in the Star Wars universe. And so it's just frustrating that it feels like we keep going back to this well. And obviously that's not going to stop because we have an Obi-Wan show set on Tatooine and going to feature Hayden Christensen. And I am excited about Hayden Christensen. I want 2022 to be the year of Hayden Christensen's redemption. Not like Darth Vader's redemption, but him as a man.
He can redeem himself for Looper.
Jumper.
No, that wasn't Looper. It was Jumper.
Jumper.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You're thinking of the sci-fi action extravaganza starring teleporting teenagers called Jumper.
Oh, I'm very sorry. How could I forget that movie?
Not the low-key sci-fi film starring Joseph Gordon-Levitt in Bruce Willis makeup.
Not to be confused with the other sci-fi low-key Loki.
Ooh, that was a good one. Bring back Loki.
Yeah, Loki was a good
one. Put Loki in Star Wars. It's fine.
Opens up one of those dimension doors.
Yeah.
Pops up in Star Wars.
It seems perfect. Fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. What could go wrong?
So everybody, thanks for watching this episode of your feature presentation. Thank you, Omar and Marty, for doing the heavy lifting with Book of Boba Fett, because I'm not going to watch it. And thank you all for hanging out. This is the outro. So I don't even, I'm bad at ending things.